Until now, the devastation had been confined largely to buildings, land and property. But on the 22nd of February, another quake struck the region, and this time, many lives were lost. The world watched, and our nation mourned.
Oh my God. The cathedral just fell. Oh my.
The first one was slower in coming, and then it built. This one was all of a sudden. It just was instant. The building I was in the city was shaking, and immediately shelves were crashing down to the floor. So this was very sudden and jerked sideways. I couldn't even stand up when I got out into the car park. I couldn't even stand up. I was knocked over.
This is unreal.
I was in my office just opposite the provincial building here, and it just absolutely concertinaed dust and debris, and it was just horrific. I could also see a glass building over here, the Brannigan's building, and the glass was just popping in and out. It looked like it was moving about a metre, and then it just absolutely shattered onto the road. It was just devastating. I don't know what the strength was, but that was certainly a pretty big quake. That was the longest shake I've ever been involved in, and look, I've been through them both now and all the aftershocks, and I don't want to go through it again, but that one seemed to never want to finish. It just kept on going and going and going. Fortunately, the building I was in is built of solid concrete, so it was pretty safe, but naturally the staff are devastated. They just gutted, really. What a shame. Just a travesty for our lovely city.
I live in the city. I was in my house in the lounge, and last time not so much came off the walls, but this time it all came. The whole house was tipped upside down. I think I've lost every vase, cup, plate, everything we own, but we're okay, and the house seems okay. Coming outside the local church on the corner, this is it, gone, completely a pile of bricks. Came into the city within about 5 minutes, cathedral spires down. There are people dead. I think a van load of people are here, and other people inside city buildings. And so many people congregating in the square, an aftershock and a huge cry, 1,000 people screaming. But the cycle of it was ferocious, and that's what's just dropped so many buildings. You know, maybe there's a lucky thing here, that the buildings that were deemed unsafe after the first were empty. If this had been the first one and not the second one, we'd be in real trouble.
Yeah. Ever felt anything like it before? Certainly pretty shocking, but we managed to get everybody out of the building, and when you look around us here, we are just so very lucky because there's an awful lot of people who are not in good shape. So, no, absolutely surreal still at the moment, but we're pretty lucky. All of our workmates are good, so that's more than a lot of people can say. Oh no, this damage, much more. There's buildings collapsed all around us now that were only slightly cracked, but they've gone. Yeah, so we're here, we're alive, so we can tell our story. I'm sorry for the people that won't be able to make it. It's going to be a pretty sad day, I think, when it's all added up.
So. We're seeing dead people on stretchers. We're seeing, you know, there's people, the cathedral square's gone, and there's people buried underneath it. Just, we're seeing
buildings have come down everywhere. Mad. Was in the bedroom, but this from way worse. A lot scarier. Not as long, but scarier. What definitely was not an aftershock.
We've just walked round and round the city all from when it happened, and we've seen.
In a bit of a daze.
Yeah, there's just been people being carried away on stretchers, and just one guy didn't look alive.
people with blood. There's got blood all over him. Yeah, that was horrible.
We went, we were in McDonald's. This old man was eating his ice cream, and he didn't even move. He just, and we, after finish, we said, "You're all right, you're all right." And he was like, "Yeah, yeah, I'm all right."
She's alive and she's well.
25 hours. 25
hours. That was unreal. Unreal. I'd assume it was me in there than her.
And did you think you'd get her out?
No.
And so when did you first find out that she was alive and well?
He rang up and said he'd found Anne. She's alive and well. And she was asking for me. And she actually gave him my phone number. How that happened, I don't know. But she must have remembered it.
I was here and I heard her call
her
number.
Yeah.
And had you dared to hope overnight that...
You always hope. I mean, I had lots of people around me helping and praying that she'd be fine. But yeah.
And she is.
I didn't think.
Did they hear her? Did she call out to them?
Yes.
And what about the rescuers? What about the guys who went under that roof?
All of those guys are just unbelievable. I've been watching them for two and a bit hours.
Yeah.
And I can't believe the job they've done in getting her out is just stupendous. As I said, you know, I'm a very happy man. Mother and father must be absolutely over the moon that she's out and she's well.
So you must be the happiest man in the world, are you?
Of course I am. I can't believe it. I obviously feel for all the other people waiting here. I know how many more are in there. When it takes so long to get somebody out. Just amazing.
What did she say to you? When she first laid
on? She hasn't, because she's got a neck brace on to just for safety reasons. So she just giggled. She had a lovely giggle and she couldn't even turn to look at me, so I'm going to have to go in.
I was at home and I lost my wife as well, because she works in the press building. So I was sitting there feeling pretty disheartened, thinking I lost everyone. And then my wife yelled out my name at home. She explained to me that she was in Les Mills gym and she watched the building next door come down. And then I started thinking about where CTV was, because Mum's only just started working there. And then I realised that's the building that my partner watched come down. So we rode into town on our push bikes. Saw the devastation, and but we had other family members to check as well. And then we left the four avenues. And that was it, we couldn't get back in. No one would let us back in because of the army, and I know they're doing their jobs, but when your mum's trapped under a whole lot of rubble, you just want to sort of be as close as you can. So we've only just managed to get here now. And no word. Been texting and ringing and nothing.
How did you feel when you saw it today compared to yesterday?
I think the scale of it at the moment is just sunk in. Pretty much didn't want to have a look at any of the footage last night, just to pray, you know, just hope. And when I arrived here today, I mean, if anyone's lived out of that, they've done well, you know. We've got a small group here. It's just my wife, my other two brothers, Matthew and Guy. They feel like me, you know, they're just gutted because Mum's like the life of the party. Well, I realised that, on the internet last night, you know, 65 dead. And I knew that Mum may be one of them. My heart goes out to everyone that's lost something. I've got to look at the worst today, because if I look at home and there is none, then it's going to feel even worse. But if I can deal with the worst now, and something good comes out of it, it's just going to make our life so good.
Well, we're really lucky. We've got a great community in Mount Batten Street, and everybody's been camped at one house and sharing gas and food and a barbecue. The sun's pretty tight.
Yeah.
Some of our other friends' children are screaming all night, every time there's a shake. So, but we're lucky, we're used to camping and things like that, and there's a great community here. So.
As you can see, there are cracks just literally that have opened up along this road all the way along. I can give you an idea of just the scale of things just by stepping down here. There are probably more than 100 cars that have just been abandoned. There are people just coming up behind me now, actually, trying to get back into their cars. We bumped into a guy who was on a push bike. He had left his car out on the road and he was biking around the city. Another woman said she described it as like Armageddon, and she just felt like she was on a ship sort of rocking all day yesterday. And so have you abandoned your car along here too?
Yes. I've just come to pick it up. It's been here for about the last couple of days, so I thought, better get it. We need the fuel, because we've got no fuel, so we need the car. Plus, I can get communication. I've got no radio at home, we've got no power, so all the batteries are now out, so we can't get them. So, of course, we now need to use our cars and do that sort of thing.
We've got water here because there used to be an old house here, and so we've put pipes into the line and we're filling some container. We've got a boiler, of course, but it's water because so far we haven't seen any sign of any truck, and water's water. So at least we've got no power, got no toilets, but we've got water.
We don't get the bloody paper even delivered.
Everyone's helping everybody else, helping out with food and that, because we've got no supermarket in this area open, so everyone's helping and giving to everybody else and being a big backup. Bit eerie at night with no street lights on. We don't want any burglars around because we can't put our alarm systems on with no power, but we're alive.
Talking to people who are desperate for food and water. We've been fortunate enough to actually catch a ride with a local. We're trying to get across to Marine Parade, which is just along the spit here. But most of these roads we've been across are just impassable at the moment. There are roadblocks up everywhere. As you can see, we're stuck in a big line of traffic here. A lot of Christchurch people are just trying to get out of the city. They've got their cars packed, caravans packed just up ahead there. The pumps have run dry, but there is a strong sense of community spirit here in Christchurch. People are sort of opening up their homes, offering beds, food, etc.
We're going to go move out to my sister's. We don't have any power, no sewage, and everything is going yuck in the fridge, so it's time to leave town. And we'll go out there for a couple of days and see what's going to happen. They had a really scary day on Tuesday. They've done lots of talking about it, and we're telling them that got to look about the positive things, because we've been really lucky. We haven't been hurt or had loss of life, so it's all in perspective, I think.
Well, we're sort of obviously concerned about all these quakes and the safety of the kids and stuff, so we've considered actually moving to Nelson. You know, because it's just too much.
Permanent move? Or just
permanent move, yeah. We were at the warehouse in Eastgate when it happened, and off the wall just collapsed. And luckily we just ran out the fire exit with our baby and the kids. But how we got out of there, I'll never know. It was amazing. But, I think we've considered and thought about definitely moving. You know, we can't put up with this. You know, it's just crazy. And our house was pretty trashed. And I'd say it's going to be written off. But we're all sleeping in the lounge and looking after each other and trying to cope.
And have you been living in Christchurch for a long time?
Yeah. Well, forever.
This
yeah, 19
home.
Years yeah. myself. Yeah.
It's a bit, pretty big call, isn't it, to move away?
It is, because when the first one happened, we thought, obviously you just forget about it and you just get on with your life. But after the second one, that was absolutely horrendous. That was that was way too much.
You can't just pack up. This is our home. Mm. You know, it's where you live. And it's where your life is, where your friends are, and it's just, yeah, gone. It's pretty bad.
Yeah, we've just been down to Couplands in Brighton, and they're giving away free bread to anyone that needs it, so that's pretty good. And we've just been down to the doctors and got a prescription for free and seen a doctor. We've been in the house for about 16 years and only really just starting to meet the neighbours in the last couple of days, so that's all pretty good.
He's actually doing a food run for people that can't get out of their houses or got no petrol. Yeah, and so just he went out to Rangiora to get supplies and just bring it back to people in like the street he lives in.
Boiling water.
Yeah.
Easier way. We ain't got no gas.
And how are you coping in general?
With community spirit, everybody's finding water and food, and we're living off the barbecue. You know, that's all you can do.
Do you have anyone staying with you?
No. But my landlord and landlady down the back, they're an older couple, and I've got my parents just round the corner, so I'm going round there now.
Sure, and your plan is to stay in Christchurch? I mean, a lot of people here's leaving.
Yeah. Most of the neighbours are talking about going.
Yeah, where are they off to?
Oh, the West Coast, Kaikoura, anywhere they can go that's stable, you know.
Do you blame them?
No, hell no. No, I wish I could go. somebody's got to stay. But, I think we're all right. The army are out here at night, the fire brigade, you know, we're not going to suffer too much more.
Do you feel safe in Christchurch?
Well, I think, you know, what can you do, you know? I mean, we could all leave, but where would we go? It's a case of digging in, isn't it?
This is the toilet, obviously. This is our door, so we know everyone's in here. So you just close it like that, and it means someone's in here.
Yeah, yeah.
Over here's a string, so when it rains, we can collect water in here, because the water will run down the string. And then we can wash our hands and stuff like that afterwards. And we've actually made a trench along there, so once we're finished, we can follow that and move the trench this way.
That's and how it. Long did that take to construct?
Oh, it took me and my brother probably a couple of hours this morning. So yeah, easy.
Yeah, everything just fell over, the roof's caved in, and that's about it.
Yeah, you can't stay in this.
No, how can you stay in that? Oh, and the whole roof's ready to fall in on it. Front bedroom, the only room that doesn't have any damage over the top of it. Yeah, we've had constant running river because of the water well over the back fence is blowing. They can't tell me when the water's going to stop running from my property like this. But what do you do? What do you do?
Where are you going?
Friends are coming to take us down to Temuka. So they said they wanted us out of here, so they're on their way up from Temuka now to pick us up. That's good friends. That's truly good friends.
We're just moving out of our home, my wife and I. The police have just been round. The civil defence will be advised, and a lot of these homes down here are condemned. He's said to us that maybe you want to get your gear while you can and get out, so because we can't come back.
That's just devastating.
Yeah, it is, but you got to keep going, you know. No one's dead. In my family, thank God, no one's lost a limb. You know, and my family, our thoughts go out to the other families because it must be absolutely horrific for a lot of the other families. Also for the economy and bits and pieces, but you know, you just got to move on. One rock's at the top of the house. Another rock has bounced and gone through the bottom. Through here. A rock that's over 2 meters long has come straight through the roof and buried itself into the floor. That is a full wooden bed. It's exploded basically, there's nothing left of it, and there's bits of it all in the wall. Around the other side, another one's hit there, and that's what's done to the house up on the corner. This one here is something to do with the rock in the middle of the soccer pitch over there, which has hit the ground. It's cleared the fence, so you can imagine the velocity of what they're doing.
How long have you lived here, mate?
6 years, mate. had it checked out before we bought it because it was a priority. You know, it's my wife and I's home. It's by no means a flash home, but we loved it to bits, you know. Been some of the people for 25 years, and yeah, I don't know.
What's the future? Where do you go?
Not here, mate. Not here.
See, the boulders have pretty much come down from the hill here. It's landed. It's hit here. So it's gone through there, pretty much landed in here. And then it's airborne straight through. Yeah, as you can see, it's come straight through the washhouse and bathroom. So luckily someone wasn't having a bath in the middle of the day. And the rocks obviously hit there. Mm-hmm. And then that's where it's landed with the cone on top there. You know, I parked my van beside it the other day, and it's pretty much the same size as my van. If not bigger, obviously a lot heavier. So it just seems strange how it's come through the house without touching the roof, pretty much same as the one up in the bedroom there.
So what have people said to you about this rock, the officials or?
Nothing to me personally. I don't know what's happening with it. Someone's gone to effort, put a cone on it so you don't miss it, so that's good. But I don't know what's going to happen to that one there. I don't know. They tell me good rocks go for good money in garden places, so maybe it's for sale, put it on Trade Me. Highest bid wins. Gotta last, don't you?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
We are here today to remember the people we have lost, to express our grief and our sorrow, and to reaffirm our commitment to this city and to each other. On the 22nd of February, Christchurch experienced an earthquake of such violence that stole from us the lives of dozens of people and dramatically altered the lives of 10,000 more.
Courage and understated determination have always been the hallmark of New Zealanders, of Cantabrians. These things the world has long known. But to see them so starkly demonstrated over these terrible, painful months has been humbling. My grandmother once said that grief is the price we pay for love.
The hour I first be.
All of us are grieving in our own way. This is just another step on the journey as we begin to rebuild our lives, to rebuild our city, and look to the future with hope and with the resilience that has made us the people of Christchurch.
There is much talk that ours is a selfish generation, focused only on money and individual gain. What I've seen in our country, and especially here in this city, since February the 22nd, puts the lie to that. I've seen people who are resilient, capable, practical, and compassionate. New Zealanders who have been generous and brave, and we are resolute. The city will be rebuilt.
With the Queen's heartfelt good wishes and those of the Prince of Wales and other members of my family, I say it to you now. Kia kaha, be strong.
And the spirit of Canterbury still remains. If you ask any affected Cantabrian how they're dealing with it, the answer is invariably similar. A stoic, oh well, there's others worse off than me. That attitude of positivity and compassion in the face of disaster exemplifies why Christchurch and Cantabrians will undoubtedly rise again.